الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. I remembered the story of this da'iya. He had no audience, so he went to the masjid every time and he put the hats on the floor. You know that story? And they said, how come you you never have anyone's listening and you always give a talk in the masjid? He said, who says no one is listening? It's there, there's at least jinns or malaika. Barakallahu fikum for attending. Don't think that a small crowd is not worth it. I'll be here for nobody. I'll come here inshallah. If I have committed, I'll come back inshallah. And if you're not interested in the fiqh, at least listen to Al-Shifa fi Ta'rif al-Huquq al-Mustafa of Imam al-Qadi Iyad, which is what we're studying with today. It's worthwhile. This is really worthwhile because we are remembering the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we don't have the chance, even though we mention him all the time, but we don't dedicate time for him to remember him sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. So in this new chapter, Al-Imam Al-Qadi Iyad speaks about the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In case someone is listening, and then we'll turn it off if they complain. So the miracles, he starts by giving some theory behind before he speaks about the actual miracles. So he says that Allah has sent prophets who were human beings. وَمَا كَانَ لِبَشَرٍ أَن يُكَلِّمَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا وَحْيًا. And these human beings are spoken to by Allah through the form of revelation. That by itself is a miracle. And then there are two forms of miracles. One that is not permissible, but it's possible for us to do, but we cannot do. Like speaking, like the Quran. Can we speak like the Quran? We can't. But we can speak, we can try. So we can make the effort to emulate the Quran, but it's impossible. For instance as well, when Allah says, Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin wa tab, Abu Lahab could have easily said, I'm a Muslim, and then he would have defeated the statement in the Quran that Abu Lahab is cursed forever. But it didn't happen. So these are the forms that are possible, but it is not, by miracle, they are conserved, they are preserved by that. He mentions other forms which falls under that. And then he says that there are forms that are not possible beyond the possibility of a human being, even the prophets themselves, and they only happen, obviously, by Allah's leave. And those are what? What are they? They are very known, which is to... Huh? Absolutely. In Shikhaq al-Qamar, to the split of the moon, bringing the dead to life, turning the staff of Musa alayhi salam from a staff to a snake, from bringing out a camel out of a stone. The Ma'idah, what happened to the Ma'idah? Yes, indeed. The full plate, the full table which has been sent to the people of Isa alayhi salam, and they ate from it. And there are many examples, the tree which spoke, the tree which walked, and the water which sprang from the fingers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all of this is impossible except by Allah's leave, and it's not even conceived that a human being can even attain, try to do this. So these are the miracles of, the two forms of miracles. And then the next question that he brings up is the Quran. Obviously, is the first of the miracles. But before that, he mentioned something else about the prophets themselves. And he said, "What is the difference between a prophet and a rasul? Rasul and nabi." Okay, there's two opinions. You wanna go try it? Yeah.
I think a rasul he's the one that receives the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the first place. But a Nabi is someone that follows the footsteps of a prophet, of a Rasul.
Okay.
Like Harun is a Nabi, but Musa is a Rasul.
That's good. That's good, inshallah. So Ar-Rasul, Ar-Rasul is the one who comes with the message. When Nabi is the one who is the one who is sent by Allah. And Safwan is saying that the Nabi is what? The one who follows?
The one that takes the footsteps of the
Safwan is saying, because in recording you cannot hear the one who speaks. So I'm repeating Safwan's words. Safwan is saying the one who follows the footsteps of the Rasul is the Nabi. And there are two opinions. The first one is that Ar-Rasul wa Nabi is one and the same. Al-Nabi is Al-Maf'ul, which is Al-Munabbi, Al-Nabi, someone who brings in the prophecy or who brings in the message. And that's why it's the same as Ar-Rasul. And Allah in Quran said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ وَلَا نَبِيٍ. So they use this as a proof. But Imam Al-Qadi'iyat said, confirming what Safwan has said, and this is the opinion of Al-Jamm Al-Ghafir, the overwhelming majority of the scholars, that there are a difference between the two, and they are using the same hadith and the same verse rather, and that's why. And he says that the Rasul is the one who brings the message.
Rasul is the one who has new his own Shariah.
Exactly.
Nabi
is the one that follows
the other Shariah.
Very nice, mashallah. Remind me of your beautiful name,
Ahmad.
Sidi Ahmad Mustafa? Yeah, so he says that Rasul is the one that comes with the Sharia, and the Nabi, who is one, he continues in that Sharia, just like Safwan had said. So, the first miracle is the Quran, and some of the scholars have said, don't say, and I believe it was an Imam Al-Lusi where I have read, you don't say small surah. That's like a demeaning to the words of Allah. It's not small, you can say short. Short surah, because it has less verses. But even he says, Imam Al-Qadi'iyah, he says, even the surah, إِنَّ أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ, every verse, فَكُلُّ آيَةٍ أَوْ آيَاتٍ مِنْهُ بِعَدَدِهَا وَقَدْرِهَا مُعْجِزًا. Every one of its verses, إِنَّ أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْطَرِ. I think they're reading the Quran of Abdi'ah. So every one of these ayahs is a miracle by itself. In fact, every letter and every word of it. So I'll stop here. I was looking for the story of Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, when he did come back to Abu Jahl, and he had heard the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had heard the Quran. He says, "Wallahi la inni ash'arukum, I am the most knowledgeable of this poetry. This Quran is not from any human being." So this is like a testimony of those who were really knowledgeable of the Arabic language. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So what we are going to try to do today is complete the fast, and we're going to start a very, very exciting chapter, inshallah, the chapter of Hajj. We'll leave zakah for another time, because zakah, a lot of it is not very applicable, like when we speak about the zakah of the farms and the zakah of the sheep and so forth. So I want to keep that another time. I'm going to try and find a way to summarize it and make it relevant to what we know, to what we live. So we're trying to complete the fiqh of Siyam, and start, inshallah, the fiqh of Al-Umrah wal-Hajj. And by that, we are asking Allah's barakah, that He will give us the chance to perform Umrah and Hajj. Ameen, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. So we spoke about the rulings of Al-Imsak. Don't you worry. Jazakallah khair. Barakallah for staying.
Not because I'm not interested, I just have another...
No, go. Barakallahu feek, barakallahu feek. So we spoke about the rulings of Imsak, in the fard al-mu'ayyan wal fard al-ghayr al-mu'ayyan, in the different forms of fasting, what we do, and why do we do imsak, and so on. So who remembers last time we spoke about, we asked the question, what happens if I fast 5 days, someone does kafara, fasts 5 days out of the 60 days, and then he misses one day? He has to repeat all the days and complete, because that has to do, it's al fardu al wajibu tatabu. It's got to be continuous.
Yeah.
Got to be continuous. Okay. Next question was, kam hiya shurutul kafarati wa ma hiya? What are the conditions of a kafara? So we're speaking about the kafara, and now we're talking in Maliki terms. Kafara is the one that is 60 days. And what is it? It's kafarat allati tajibu ala as-sa'imi shurutun khamsa. There are five conditions for this kafara to be applicable. The first one, al-amd. Someone has to have eaten purposefully. So someone who is forgetful, obviously, doesn't have to do kafara. Someone who eats, not knowing or forgetful, he doesn't have to do kafara. He doesn't have to do 60 days. Again, this is in the Maliki only. In the other schools, it's not that. وَالْإِخْتِيَارُ فَلَا كَفَرَةَ عَلَى مَنْ كُرِهَ مُكْرِهَ مِنْ أَفْطَرَ غَلَبَةً. And it has to be same as the first one. It's purposefully and by choice. So if someone forces someone to eat, so it's not just forgetful, but by choice. So someone who is forced by some reason, he doesn't have to do kafara. So it's by choice. The third condition, al-intihaku lihurmati shahr, it must be the Ramadan. So this is because, so it is only for the sacrosanctity of the month of Ramadan. فَلَا كَفَّرَةَ عَلَى مَنْ تَأَوَّلَ قَرِيبًا. Except for those who have, who doesn't have any knowledge, or whose interpretation is not well-founded because of his knowledge, or because he's new to Islam, or simply for his ignorance. For someone who ate because of that, it has no kafara. So al-intihak. So they're all very close to one another. So do it purposefully, by choice, and it's, you know, doing the kafara, doing the fasting, the breaking the fast in Ramadan. All of these are very close. Wa an yakuna aliman bil hurma. Again, something which is very similar to the third one. He knows that Ramadan is, there's a hurma to it, a sacrosanctity, and he still eats. That person, obviously, he does kafara. So this is another condition for the kafara. And the fifth one is very close to the other one, so no need to repeat. أن يكون الصوم في خصوص صوم رمضان. If it's not Ramadan, there's no kafara, obviously. So they are very, very specific. The scholars make sure that they cover every angle. The other question, كم هم الأفراد الذين يجب عليهم القضاء والكفارة ومن هم? Who are the people? Which people are, have to, it is an obligation for them to do قضاء and كفارة. Someone who says, or someone who sleeps with his wife on the day of Ramadan, which brings everyone in the condition, in this situation. Someone who sleeps with his wife, his spouse, in Ramadan has to do kafara. What happens? Just the kafara or also qada? Question. Is kafara sufficient? Both. Both, he has to do qada and kafara. If you remember the story of the Arabi who told the Prophet this hadith is sahih. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, I slept with my wife in Ramadan. And he says, you have to feed, I don't know which, or I think the order was like that, to feed 60 people. He says, I cannot feed anyone. He says, you have to fast 60 days. He says, I cannot fast 60 days. I think that then he said, you have to feed 60 people. He says, I can't feed 60 people. I am the poorest person. Then he asked for someone to bring in irqun min tamr, like a whole branch filled with dates. And interestingly, that irq, that branch of the tree, was exactly 15 sa'. And this is by itself a miracle. Wallahu alam. This is like a, I think, not too many people notice this, but this irq of tamr was 15 sa'. 15 sa' is 30 amdad. 15 sa', so, or 60 amdad. So you have to feed the poor 60 people, each person one mud. Each mud is two handfuls of food of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's hands. No more, no less. This is the mud. So in that irq, there were 60, exactly 60 mud. 15 sa', exactly 16 mud. So that's, I think, is a miracle that the irq came and it was exactly as it was supposed to be. Some people look at that hadith and they say, fine, the kafara is for 60 people to feed, but they don't pay attention that there's also a qada. This is the kafara, but there is a qada that the Prophet already spoke about in previous hadith, in other hadith. So there is a qada and a kafara. Al-afradu alladhina yajibu alayhim al-qada wal-kafara. Who are they? The two of them, al-qada wal-kafara. Again, we're repeating the same thing we said before. So bear with me, this could be a little monotonous, but inshallah, we want to earn the barakah of the way the book is organized. وَالْمُنْتَهِكُ لِحُرْمَةِ رَمَضَانَ بِالْجِمِعِ. The one who has breached the sacrosanctity of Ramadan by sleeping with his spouse. How is that defined? The definition of sleeping with a person, someone's spouse, is that the sexual organs have met. The two sexual organs have met. Or the second one, المخرجو للمني بمباشرة أو غيرها. What is also another is to have had the sexual pleasure. So the many has come out from the sexual pleasure. The third one, so if someone, for instance, in Ramadan thinks about certain things that arouses him sexually, and usually that does not amount to having a pleasure, like I don't want to use explicit words because I'm in the masjid, but otherwise the scholars do use them. But if it's not usual for him or for her to reach that level, that climatic level, and he gets that climatic level, he does not have to do kafara. Because usually when he thinks, in usual days, he doesn't get there. But one time it happened, so he doesn't have to do kafara. May Allah forgive us and may Allah protect us from that. The third one, وَمَنْ رَفَعَ نِيَّةَ صَوْمِهِ نَهَارًا أَوْ لَيْلًا وَاسْتَمَرَّ نَاوِيًا عَدْمَ صَوْمِ حَتَّى طَلَعِ الْفَجْرِ. The person who makes the intention during the day or at night, just the intention, he didn't eat. He made the intention not to fast or to break the fast. Or at night, he made the intention not to fast the next day for no reason. Or for thinking that he was, for instance, going to travel. The person says, tomorrow I'm traveling. In the Maliki, this is he has to do kafara. Okay, so we're talking about strictly about the Maliki. لِأَنَّ نِيَّةَ إِبْطَالِ الصَّوْمِ وَالصَّلَاةِ الْأَثْنَاءِ مَتَابِرِ خَلَاةِ رَفْضِهَا أَنَّ يَضُرُّ رَفْضُ الْحَيَاةِ and so on. Okay, we spoke about this in the past. وَمَنْ And the fourth one, وَمَنْ أَوْصَلَ مُفْطِرًا مِنْ مَائِعٍ أَوْ غَيْرِهِ الْمَاعِدَةِ خُصًا. It's, again, we know about this, we're just going to mention it, is to eat or drink through the mouth. Obvious, okay? The fifth one, وَالْجَاهِلُ وُجُوبِ الْكَفَّارَةِ مَعَ عِلْمِ بِحُرْمَةِ الْفِطْرِ فَأَفْطَرَ وَالْجَاهِلُ وُجُوبِ الْكَفَّارَةِ مَعَ عِلْمِهِ بِحُرْمَةِ الْفِطْرِ فَأَفْطَرَ. This one, this person does, he knows that it's haram. He knows that one should not break the fast. But he does not know the hurma, how serious it is. Even that person has to do kafara. The one who purposefully throws up and then he swallows his. So if he throws up purposefully, then he has to do qada. In the Maliki, if he swallows it, he has to do kafara as well. Again, if this happens to anybody, I think you should go to a scholar and get a fatwa, because the Maliki is very, very strict here. وَمَنْ تَأَوَّلَ تَأْوِيلًا بَعِيدًا. تَأْوِيلًا بَعِيدًا is the one who makes an interpretation which is not regular, not usual. You know, if someone is a new Muslim, if someone is ignorant and he has, it's very close, then he's okay. But if it's تَأْوِيلًا بَعِيدًا, cannot be thinking this. It's not likely. So there's a difference between ta'wil al-ba'id and ta'wil al-qarib. A ta'wil al-qarib is someone who makes an interpretation out of an ambiguity. Okay, this can be acceptable, but something which is far from that ambiguity, then it's ta'wil al-ba'id, and that person will have to do qada. Again, one should always consult a scholar and understand the entire situation. وَمَنْ أَفْطَرَ لِحُمَّى أَوْ لِحَيْدٍ ظَنَّ أَحَدُهُمَ يَقْعَلُهُ فِي ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ. Someone who wakes up in the morning and he starts to feel ill and he says, you know what, I think I'm going to get a fever. Or someone wakes up, a woman wakes up in the morning and she says, today is my day for the menses. So she eats, but she doesn't get her menses. And the man or the woman doesn't get the fever. He's perfectly fine. He just was a little sick in the morning, but he was fine the rest of the day. That person, he eats, obviously. But what we're talking about here is he eats, he does qada, and does kafara. So in the Maliki as well, in the other schools it's different. He does qada, but he has sinned. In all the schools, they have sinned, athima. But in the Maliki, there is a qada and there is a kafara. In the other schools, there is a qada only, no kafara. And the tenth one, وَمَنْ أَفْطَرَ عَلَى لَزِمَهُ عَلَى لِعِزْمِهِ عَلَى السَّفَرِ فِي ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ وَلَمْ يُسَافِرْ فِيهِ. Someone, like we said earlier, someone who wakes up in the morning, I'm going to travel. He already made the intention to fast the night before. Even if he doesn't make the intention to fast and he doesn't travel, he has to do qada and kafar. So this is strictly in the Maliki. I know it, I think it's in the Hanbali, where if he travels, it's in all the schools. If he travels, he doesn't have to do kafara. If he travels, they say it's he has sinned, but it is not kafara. Next question: كم هم الأفراد الذين يجب عليهم القضاء دون الكفارة? What are those people or the situations, the conditions where you do qada but you don't do kafara? There's a lot of differences of opinions between the schools, but we're sticking to the Maliki. What are the conditions where you do only qada and you don't do kafara? And I think you will all understand the following conditions because they happen often. The one who eats forgetfully during the day. In the other schools, there's no qada. In the Maliki, there is qada. Someone eats forgetfully during the day of Ramadan. He eats, it's Ramadan. Of course, he keeps fasting, but he has to do qada. In the Maliki, he has to do qada. Clear? We covered that last time, remember? Okay. وَمَنْ أَفْطَرَ جَاهِلًا رَمَضَانَ بِأَنَّ ظَنَّهُ شَعْبَانَ أَوْ جَاهِلًا يَوْمًا مِنْ رَمَضَانَ بِأَنَّهُ ظَنَّ يَوْمًا مِنْ شَعْبَانَ كَيْمُ الشَّكْرِ. That's, we've also covered that right in the beginning of this this chapter, which is someone who thinks it's ظَنَّ شَعْبَانَ. It's Sha'ban. أَفْطَرَ جَاهِلًا مِنْ رَمَضَانَ. He thinks it's Sha'ban, but it was Ramadan, obviously, that day. Yawm al-Shak, but he still does not know. He remains under the impression that it is Sha'ban, but it was Ramadan. It is Yawm al-Shak, obviously. But no one told him that it is Ramadan. And so he has to make up that day, obviously. It's qada, but no kafara, obviously. وَمَنْ سَبَقَهُ الْمَاء غَلَبَةً. Again, we spoke about this. Someone who did wudu and he drank it غَلَبَةً, out of his control. He does qada. وَمَنْ أُكْرِهَ عَلَى تَنَوُلِ الْمُفْتِرِ. Again, we mentioned it earlier. Someone who was forced, mukrih. He eats, he continues the imsak after, but then he does qada of that day. وَمَنْ ابْتَلَعَ جَوْزَ الْإِسْتِيَاكِ نِسْيَانًا. Someone who wash, does the toothbrush, or he uses miswak, or he uses jawza. This is a different type of toothbrush which beautifies your. They use it. I don't know in which countries. I know the Africans and North Africans use that. There is a root or a branch that they use to make their lips darker.
Oh yeah.
You know that?
Yeah. In our area, mostly ladies.
Yes. Yes.
They use it.
Yes. So it's that.
They were not lipsticks before.
Exactly.
They were using that kind of tree skin.
Yes.
They chew it and it colored lips.
Exactly. So I guess it's not just in North Africa and the African countries. It's also in the yeah. So the fuqaha have spoken about this. So if someone has that in their mouth and they're rubbing, and all of a sudden they forgetfully. Comes in, they have to do qada. Someone who comes back from a trip before Fajr, and he thinks this is ta'wil al-qarib, he thinks he doesn't have to fast that day, but it's before Fajr, qada only. This is ta'wil al-qarib. The one who travels, but he did not reach the distance of the musafir, because we have two distances. There is like a buffer. In the when we speak about the shortening of the prayer, when we speak about starting to breaking the fast, when you travel, when can you start breaking your fast? There is like a buffer. There's a minimum, and then there's a before the minimum. Before the minimum is the buffer. Anyway, so someone remains within the minimum, that buffer, he doesn't go beyond, that person has to do qada. Okay, so it says, مَنْ سَافَرَ دُونَ مَسَافَةِ الْقَصْرِ فَظَنَّ إِبَاحَةَ الْفِطْرِ فَأَفْطَرَ. So he has not gone beyond the minimum, and then he started to eat. وَمَنْ رَأَى شَوَّالَ نَهَارًا يَوْمَ الثَّلَاثِينَ. This is very interesting. وَمَنْ رَأَى هِلَالَ شَوَّالَ. So now in Ramadan, you're on the 30th day of Ramadan. You're on the 30th day of Ramadan. And then you see the hilal before sunset. Is that possible? Is that possible? No, that day is not Shawwal. See, you made a mistake. Okay. So when there is a difference of opinion in different schools, do we have Eid the next day, or do we have Ramadan the next day if we see the hilal during the day, before Zawal, or obviously, after Maghrib, it's agreed upon. But what happens if we see it before? There's differences of opinion. Same with the day of Shawwal. The first day of Shawwal, if we see the Hilal during the day of Ramadan on the 30th, in the Maliki, no. The next day is? Yes, it's Shawwal. But that day is Ramadan.
Oh, okay.
Okay? That day is Ramadan. So it says, "Woman." I'll repeat it so that anyone who understands Arabic on the audio, "وَمَنْ رَأَى هِلَالَ شَوَّالَ نَهَارًا يَوْمَ الثَّلَاثِينَ مِنْ رَمَضَانَ فَظَنَّ أَنَّهُ يَوْمُ عِيدٍ فَأَفْطَرَ." He thinks that day is Ramadan, so it's Eid. No, that day is still Ramadan. Shawwal is the next day. You may be able to see Hilal on the 30th day of Ramadan. "وَمَنْ أَصَابَتْهُ جَنَابَةٌ لَيْلًا." And the one who has janaba, everyone knows janaba. Janaba who needs the major tahara. He has slept with his wife at night, and he wakes up after Fajr, and he did not wash. So he thought that he should have washed at night. So now his fasting is not valid. So he thinks that his fasting is not valid. Again, this is from the ta'wil al-qarib, so that's excusable, but he has to do qada. Jazakallah khair. I'll repeat this in Arabic. من أصابه جنابة ليلا فأصبح جنوبا ولم يغتسل إلا بعد الفجر فظن إباحة الفطر فأفطر. He eats and he keeps eating. Does not even do imsak. ومن احتجم نهارا فأفطر. The one who does cupping. You know cupping? Hijama. Hijama. Blood.
Oh, the one that you do in Hajj?
Yeah, you do it there, yeah, but it's but don't do it during Hajj. There is a whole discussion about doing hijama during Hajj. In the Maliki, it's makruh. Why? To do hijama during Hajj, it's makruh because...
No, what is hijama?
Hijama is the Chinese cupping. From the blood.
Acupuncture.
Not acupuncture, it's also Chinese.
Yeah,
it's a cup. You there's two ways of doing it. It's either you put the cup on your back or whatever you want to apply it, and then you suck the air, and then you can do dry cupping or blood cupping. The dry cupping, you don't cut on the skin. The blood cupping is you cut, and then the blood is sucked out, and you see the heavy, dirty bloods coming out. That's one way of doing it. The other way of doing it is you throw in a match and you put it on the skin, so when the oxygen is sucked out, it starts sucking the skin or the blood. Okay, this is cupping. It's in the sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ used to do this. Some people consider it sunnah, others consider it just medicine. Okay,
like even now some athletes, like I've been hearing, they've been using it more often now.
Subhanallah.
Athletes, yeah.
Yeah,
they've been using it now because it helps their body.
So, Wazir is saying that athletes are using it because it helps them.
No, they do when they have any problem.
That too,
but sometimes they do it regularly just to keep themselves healthy. It just removes all the bad blood that's in your body.
It removes all the bad blood. I know someone from work, he had like a form of cancer, and he was prescribed not cupping. I told him, why aren't you doing cupping? It's just removing. He says they remove a certain portion of the blood. So they do it in a certain way. So it's really cupping. And anyway, so the cupping in Hajj, he spoke about Hajj. Cupping at Hajj is makruh in the Malikiya during the Ihram, when you are in Ihram, because you will have to remove the hair. And hair? You don't remove hair while you're in Ihram.
Yeah.
So if you remove hair, you have to do a fidya, or you have to do something to correct your what you have done. In Ramadan, it is permissible unless it makes you weak. So it says, someone, man asabatu waman dhanna, who's taking pictures? Waman ihtajaba naharan aftara, someone who does hijama during the day and he thinks it broke his fast. Oh, now we understand. Allahu Akbar. That's the lightning. I thought someone was taking pictures. La ilaha illallah. May Allah protect us. May Hellfire protect our children and increase us in knowledge. وَمَنْ ظَنَّ عَدْمَ وَجُوبِ لِإِمْسَاكِ فَأَفْطَرَ يَوْمَ الشَّكِ. What happens on the day of Shak, yeah, Safwan?
Like, it's the day...
On the day of Shak, you're fasting or not, that doesn't matter. But as soon as you hear that it is Ramadan, what do? You continue to fast. It's imsak. You do imsak. So the one, وَمَنْ ظَنَّ عَدْمَ مُجُوبٍ imsak. Someone, again, it's تَأْوِيلُ الْقَرِيبُ. Someone who didn't think that it is an obligation to do imsak on the day of shirk. Shirk? Shirk, shirk, shirk. Shirk, shirk. Safwan. Someone who thought that it's not an obligation and he kept eating on that day, it's only qada.
No, it's okay at the beginning of Ramadan. But the same situation if it happened on the end of Ramadan.
Yeah.
You were celebrating Eid and you after some time somebody say, oh,
it's Ramadan.
It's Ramadan, it's not Eid.
You have to do imsak. Yeah, that applies. وَمَنْ تَسَحَّرَ بِلَسْقِ الْفَجْرِ. Ah, this is a long topic. I don't know if I should stop here after that. This is a very interesting topic. And it was covered when the sister asked. Remember? When she says, when do we stop imsak? When do we eat? When do we stop eating? So here's the ruling. It says here. It says, where were we? وَمَنْ تَسَحَّرَ بِلَسْقِ الْفَجْرِ فَظَنَّ بُطْلَانَ الصَّوْمِ فَأَفْطَرَ. This person kept eating until Fajr started. You can go, Safwan. You have to go?
Huh?
You have to go?
I'm not sure, maybe.
Don't worry about it, go.
Okay.
Jazakallah khair. After you leave, I'm going to talk about you. I'll say that. Safwan. Allah harda alayka Safwan. Jazakallah. Man, so the person who kept eating until the last moment, and then he doubts whether he ate after the adhan, he ate after fajr or not. So he doubted, and after doubting, he says, I'm going to eat. That person does qada, and does not do kafara. The reason why I said it's a long topic, and this should be like a nice dissertation during Ramadan, because a lot of people have this misconception. There's obviously some people who say, like the sister who told us, so can we eat? Can we keep eating until the adhan is called? Yes. You have to be careful. I know I've heard of an opinion. No doubt. There is an opinion. Al-Wahid, what are you thinking? Al-Wahid comes with his...
I don't know in Arab country.
Yes.
But like in Pakistan, India, Bangladesh.
Yes.
When Adhan, Fajr Adhan starts.
Yes.
It takes maybe 15, 20 minutes.
Yes.
Because everybody has not the same time.
Okay.
They have different time.
Yes.
So first Adhan and the last Adhan in between, maybe there are 20 minutes, 15 minutes, because everybody has different
time. Okay.
And you can hear Adhan.
Okay.
And it's commonly understood that as long as you listen Adhan, you can finish your
okay. Song. Okay, so that's the opinion of some people, some scholars, that as long as the Adhan is being called, you can keep eating. And it's from the Hadith Sahih, I think it's Bayhaqi. It says, إِذَا سَمِعَ أَحَدُكُمُ النِّدَاءَ وَالْإِئْنَاءُ عَلَىٰ يَدِهِ فَلَا يَضَعُهُ حَتَّى يُقْضِي حَاجَتَهُ مِنْهُ. If you hear the Adhan, if any of you hear the Adhan and the vessel or the food is in your hand, do not drop it, do not let it down until you finish what you are doing. Okay. This hadith has to be put in context. Okay, so you say yes, here's the hadith. A lot of people go crazy. They say, this is the dalil. Where is the fiqh? If you're a scholar of hadith, that's fine. We say this hadith is sahih. But we have to bring all the hadith together and understand. And al-Imam al-Nawawi says, من طلع الفجر وفي فيه طعام فليلفظه ويتم صومه وهذا لا خلاف فيه. He says, if the Fajr has come in, and in your mouth is food, then you must remove the food from your mouth. If you know for sure that the Fajr is in, then you must remove the food from your mouth, and there is no difference of opinion in this. He didn't say ijma', he didn't say there's consensus, he just said there's no differences of opinion on this. Meaning that when the adhan is called, we're not sure whether they are basing it on an accurate timing or schedule, then maybe you can, there is like a leeway there. But even then, listen to this hadith. And everyone knows the hadith of Bilal and Ibn Maktum in Bukhari and Muslim. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إن بلالا يؤذن بليل فكلوا واشربوا حتى يؤذن ابن أم مكتوب. Bilal calls the adhan at night. Eat. That's the meaning of this hadith, the other one. If there's something in your hand, keep eating it until you're done. When Bilal calls the adhan, keep eating until Ibn Umm Maktum calls the adhan. Then you stop eating. There's two fajr. We know that there's fajr kadhib fajr sadiq. There is the false fajr, and there is the true fajr. When the false fajr comes, Bilal calls the adhan of fajr.
Every day?
Every day.
Okay.
Every day. In Medina, mm-hmm. When I was a student, alhamdulillah, I used to hear two adhan before fajr. Yes, one before, not everywhere. Sometimes in the haram, you will hear two. When I went, when we were there,
there were
two of them.
There were two of them.
Yeah. But one for tahajjud.
Yes, tahajjud or suhoor. Or having suhoor, right? Tahajjud or suhoor. And there's also the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, Anas radiallahu anhu says, we ate until we were done. And when we were done, the Prophet ﷺ went to pray. He asked Anas radiallahu anhu, how much time was there between eating and the Prophet praying? He says, 50 verses. That means there is a time. And some of the later scholars, not just in what you're saying is not everywhere in the Indian, you know, subcontinent. It's very, very rare. Like the most of the Ahnaf, in fact, you go to the mosques here of the Ahnaf and you will find a schedule with a line of imsak, with a schedule for imsak. And some people say this is bid'ah. It's not bid'ah. It's a strong reminder. The only thing is some of them make it half an hour. So my God, I'm going to have to wait. I'm going to eat and wait a whole half hour before I pray. It's very burdensome. But this is the scholars that they do that. The scholars have said that. How much time? That's an interpretation. Some of the Moroccan scholars in Fes, and this is a city of scholars, they've interpreted that duration of about 20 minutes, the 50 verses of 20. About 20 minutes. So that's what I wanted to. Inshallah, there was. It's got to be better organized in terms of presentation about this topic. But this is the last thing we are going to speak about. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Jazakumullahu khair.
I have a question.
Yes.
If somebody say I'm going to travel tomorrow morning before Fajr or at night, he say